was an unreal finish in Game 6 between the Sharks and the Knights. Mike McKenna chiming in on McKenna in game. This is a new Twitter account. He's tweeting about nothing but the Stanley Cup playoffs.
Bye.
He said, so you all realize that when Hertl went to shoot, his stick hit the defenseman's just before release and changed the trajectory of the shot, right? That's not where he was aiming or where Fleury read it going. Any goalie can tell you how hard that is to deal with. And we enjoy this McKenna in-game Twitter account, so we welcome Mike McKenna onto the show live here on NHL Now.
Yeah.
We're going to get to the Hertl goal last night in a second, but first I got to address this microphone you're rocking right now.
Yeah.
Professional gear, sir.
Yeah, somewhat. I mean, you can pick this up at any Best Buy. All it is a Blue Yeti. I got it a couple of months ago because I've been tinkering around with doing some podcasting, and I thought I needed to at least look like a pro if I was going to do this stuff.
Very shiny. It looks like you spent a lot of money on a very shiny microphone.
Yes.
I buff it every night, make sure it was ready for something like this. I want the appearance to look like it's the right thing.
Oh, my goodness. Let's go back to that double overtime winner from Tomas Hertl, because your tweet was really interesting. These guys broke down the goal earlier in the show. Did you recognize that immediately, or was it something that you noticed on the replay?
Oh, it was immediate. As soon as the puck went in the net, I said to myself, something had to happen here, but it's because I could tell that Fleury did not read that puck off the blade cleanly. And when something like that happens, you look back at the replay immediately to find out what happened. And so as soon as I did, I went, yep, it either deflected off the stick or something changed the angle. And sure enough, it was, I think it was Theodore's stick coming back that hits Hertl's stick and completely changes the trajectory of where the shot's going.
Yeah, I mean, once we got a better look at that, we can see that you're absolutely right about that. And it really threw, I think, Marc-Andre Fleury for a loop there. Is that, I mean, you obviously lived this, you know, your whole life playing the position. Is it something that really changed? It must have changed it really dramatically for Fleury, because he was really leaning towards the glove and then that puck came back the other way.
Yeah, exactly. And, you know, there'd been some talk about whether he was sitting on a high shot to his glove side because there'd been previous goals there in the series by that player. And I don't believe that to be the case here. I think that he's truly reading the puck off the blade of the stick in the instance that it happened. And like I said, what happened was when the two sticks collided, the puck ended up going the other direction. You can see it fluttering, so it didn't track where it normally would. Mm-hmm. And when it's that close, the puck's coming that quick, you just can't adjust to it in time. Now, I also never said that whether he should have stopped the puck or shouldn't it, but everybody seemed to think that I'm just being a goalie apologist here and saying, oh, yeah, you can't stop that thing, and I never did that.
People criticized you on Twitter? That's
can't
shocking.
That. Yeah, that is shocking. Yeah.
I like the term, too. Goalie apologist, I think we've landed a new – I really like this new clinical term.
Yeah.
Yeah, well, maybe that goes back to some of the goalie coaches I've worked with. We all have these terms for, you know, whether it's goalie apologist or the goalie union, those things. But, you know, there's things about that goal that could have potentially helped Fleury stop it. There's things that make it really difficult. And all I'm trying to do is provide analysis that shows what happened. The why is really important on that. And to just come out immediately say it's a horrible goal that should have been stopped, I didn't feel like it was very fair to Marc-Andre Fleury.
Hey, Mike, let me take you into another series. And I think one of the really remarkable turnarounds or remarkable stories has been the play of Martin Jones for the San Jose Sharks. Seemed to be a turning point in and around game 4 for San Jose at the goaltending position. Curious to get your thoughts on Marty Jones and how he's kind of seems to have been a mechanic to his own game to some degree.
Yeah, there's a couple things at play there. And one of them is that I saw Martin Jones dominate the American Hockey League for the better part of 2.5-3 seasons before he finally got his NHL chance. And I think he's a tremendous goaltender. And sometimes when it comes time to playoffs, it takes a couple games for you to really lock in, get your confidence, and know that you can do this. And for myself, I crossed that bridge, 3 years ago in the American League. And I'm 33 years old when that happened, and now I'm 36. So it took me a long time in my career before I eventually got it to click and realize I can do this. I can still play my game, be dominant, and win games in the playoffs. And I think that's what you're seeing with him right now.
And, you know, to that point, I'll follow up with a question about Jordan Binnington, because he is someone that has kind of spent some time in the minor leagues, kind of work on his game. He got moved out of his own organization and lent to another organization that showed you, I don't think, a real vote of confidence at that time, as you could probably discuss as well when it comes to goalies. But give me your thoughts on Binnington and his emergence this year and how well he has played.
I'm not surprised by it at all. Like you alluded to, he'd been biding his time, you could say. I guess, what, 3-4 years in the American League and 1 year in the ECHL. And he's always been good wherever he's been. He was an all-star last year in Providence. I've actually never played against him because in the American League, if you're in the East, you don't play the teams in the West and vice versa. But, you know, last year was also kind of an aberration because St. Louis didn't have a primary affiliate. They had players primarily between Chicago and San Antonio, but they did have a couple other people who were essentially cast off. And that's what happened to him. And, you know, he's stuck with it. He's worked really hard, and you can tell that he's playing in the moment and he's riding a wave of confidence right now.
Mike, there's an important Game 6 transfers back to Dallas, one of your recent stops, and I'd be curious to hear your thoughts about the Bishop-Hudobin tandem in Dallas. It seems to be certainly a situation where Bishop is flourishing, but Hudobin has been terrific relief when called upon.
No question. Both those guys have done an excellent job this year. You look at how they work with goalie coach Jeff Reese there, who I think an awful lot of. We had a great time working together last year. They've really honed in on what works for both goaltenders. You know, Bish and Hudobin play different styles, but the hallmark of somebody who really is able to work with goaltenders is to do the best job they can with two people that work differently than one another. And Bish has been amazing so far, but if it's called upon and Hudobin ever needs to hop in there, I'm sure that that team in green has every bit of confidence in him just as well as they do in Bish.
All right, one more for you, Mike. Based on what you've seen in these Stanley Cup playoffs so far, if you had to pick one goaltender as the best performer in these playoffs so far, which goaltender has impressed you the most this postseason?
Oh, that's tough. And I'm going to be really honest with you that I haven't paid extreme attention to every single series, but I do want to notice though and point out that 4-0 Columbus goes and wins, and Sergei Bobrovsky, people had always associated question marks with what he could do in playoffs, and I think he answered a lot of things there. And like I said before about Martin Jones, sometimes it's just a matter of gaining the confidence that you can do it on the big stage, and I'm looking for a lot more out of him going forward, because I think he's head and shoulders one of the best goaltenders in the world.
I think that's a great answer, because he silenced those critics for sure.
No question. Hey, before we let you go, I got the question for you. where are you playing next year? I mean, or what number of cities will you be in? I mean, you had a rough year this year bouncing around. You've handled it really great. What do you think for next year for you?
I don't know. Somebody's going to have to really flatter me to get me to decide to put the pads on, I think, after last season. I'm not sure what the future holds right now. You're right. I played in 5 cities this season, which I never expected coming into it. And quite frankly, this season for me was an opportunity for my 3-year-old daughter to remember me as a goaltender. And she got to see me play for about a month and a half or 2 months in person. But when we did, we made the most of it. You can't ever complain about being in the NHL because it's where we all want to be. And I was really fortunate to be there for a lot of this season.
Great. All right, well, you got a cool microphone. You're very well spoken.
Very well spoken.
You might have a home in broadcasting. I don't know. I'm just
good
saying.
Good luck with the podcast. Good luck with the podcast.
Yeah, I appreciate it. 6 degrees with Mike McKenna. It's a shameless self-promotion there.
Now you're definitely in the business. Now you're definitely in the business. But keep playing. You still got a lot of game left.
Thanks. I appreciate you guys having me on. That was a lot of fun.
No, thanks for coming on. Maybe we'll talk to you.
We'll
down
do it
the
again.
Hey, I'm set up and ready. Look at this beautiful studio. You can't even see my clothes or shoes in the background. They're in here.
Yeah.
I love it. Thanks, Mike.